tell him to the alligator's back. Try and use my weight to kind of limit how much they can move. Once we get here, let the alligator catch his breath. Getting on their back, as you guys kind of notice here, not nearly as hard as you might expect. And the secret to it is these animals have really good eyesight. Unfortunately for them, they have a very limited field of vision. The alligator's head is facing off in the opposite direction. Now otherwise, if he has it turned off to the side one way or the other, or if you try and approach him from an angle, you're going to risk entering into that field of vision. And if they see you coming, they're going to try and defend themselves by swinging around. They'll try and grab you halfway. All right? So it's very important. The alligator's head is facing off in the opposite direction when you're ready to jump on. Once you get here, get your... We've got a buffet line set up over here. Got another one up there. So when you get here, you want to get your knees up in the armpits. You also want to get your feet kind of tucked in back by the hind legs. That's going to prevent the alligator from standing up and then backing out from underneath me. I'll let you guys figure out why I don't want him to do that. Next thing you want to do is get a hold of the mouth. Safest way to do it, start your hands off on the neck. Slowly slide your hands up around the mouth. Force those jaws shut as you work your hands up to the front of the face. If you do it right, it's going to look something like that. That's one method. Okay, the other method, a little bit sneakier. Right, back to the limited field of vision, there's another blind spot right in front of the face. So as long as I don't pull my hand off to the side too far, I can reach over the front, grab the lower jaw, bring that up to the top jaw, and get the same effect. Now you notice both times when I did that, I went ahead and I rocked, or kind of tilted the alligator's head back with me. From that position, your alligator's a lot less likely to walk forward with me on his back. It also helps prevent the alligator from rolling underneath us. So any chance we get where we can limit their movement, we're going to take advantage of it. That's again the reason why you rock back on the head. Okay? Now, what allows us to do this? And some of you guys have already heard things like this before. An alligator this size is going to produce about 20 to 90 pounds of opening pressure in the mouth. They're relatively weak when it comes to opening their mouth up. Their power comes when they close the mouth. Okay, the same alligator, when he goes to bite, he's going to produce somewhere between 900 to maybe 3,000 pounds of closing force. So you can hold their mouth shut, but if you're holding it open and the alligator decides to close it, that's where you're going to run into problems at. I'm going to try and show you guys just how quick they can get that mouth closed. Watch really close here and listen. Everybody hear that? Yeah, there's always one wise guy out there. I didn't have my finger on the trigger there. To do it right, they got a very sensitive mouth. When you go in there, just barely touch the lower gum line that triggers the mouth to come shut. That popping sound is the sound of the jaws coming together. If you do that wrong, that's more of a sickening crunch. You get a lot of screaming and profanity. So you can tell if you're doing it right or not. It should give you an idea how powerful those jaws are, though. Now, the other thing here, while the mouth is open, if you get a chance to look inside here, you guys notice how you can't see down this alligator's throat? Okay, that's because the back of their tongue operates like a valve. That allows them to open their mouth up underwater. They don't have to worry about water rushing into their stomachs or rushing into their lungs. The nose, or nostrils up here at the front of the mouth, are also equipped with a valve, as are the ears. The ears are back here behind the eyes. So the animal's pretty much watertight from all these different entry points. They can close them up with all the different valves. And then the eyes are also kind of neat. If you watch when they open up, you get a rolling effect. It's like they're rolling into the head. That's caused by a second eyelid that you and I don't have, called the nictitating membrane. That's kind of like a built-in pair of diving goggles. So they use that eyelid when they're underwater. It's going to keep the dirt and debris out of the eye, but it allows the alligator to see what's going on around it. All right? These are just a few little adaptations that they possess for that aquatic life or the semi-aquatic life that they live. Right? Okay, those are the things I wanted to show you on the alligator's back. When you're ready to hop off. When you're ready to hop off, cover up their eyes. It helps calm them down a little bit. Wait till it calms down. Your exit point is directly behind you, so you do want to check, make sure his little buddies aren't sneaking up on you here. Coast is clear. Push his head into the dirt, and then just back straight off. There you go. Okay, now when we feed him, we feed him in every show that we do. We do about 6 shows a day. And what's going to happen is if we're coming out that often and we're tossing food out. So what we've done is we've tried to condition them to associate the bucket and a tapping sound with being fed. Obviously, some of them started recognizing other parts of the show. That's why they do start lining up long before I had the bucket up here. We still use the sound signal though, so we'll go ahead and tap on the bucket here a couple of times. Hopefully we'll get a few more of them come out of the water. You ready? Hey, I haven't tapped on it yet. Very well trained. Alright, sound signal. That's pretty much all it takes. Once they hear that noise, they know it's time to eat. We're feeding them chicken, but they'll eat any kind of meat. Red meat, fish or fowl. A lot of times they'll also scavenge, so they don't necessarily have to kill what they intend to eat. Kind of goes back to what we were saying before, that they're not picky. If you'll notice that when they get the food in their mouth, they make a lot of chewing motion. Here, ding dong. There, okay. They make a lot of chewing motions, but they're not really chewing the food in the sense of the word. They're better situating it in their mouth so that it's a little bit easier for them to swallow it. That's all that chewing motion is really going to do for them. They also have a hard time picking food up off of the ground because of how they're physically built. Okay, their mouth is too long. Their neck is too short and muscular to reach out and grab things with the front of their face. That's why you'll see them kind of twist or roll their heads off to the sides when they pick that food up. Also have a hard time seeing once it hits the ground. It goes back to that limited field of vision. But you'll see them, they'll kind of drag their chins across the grass or the gravel. Once they feel the chicken, of course, they'll pick it up. There's a bunch of rocks in there, too, that they know. Spit those out. It's a tough chicken today. Alright, in the water, because of how the tongue operates like a cow, they can't swallow underwater, so you'll see them bring their heads up, they'll tilt the head back, let the food slide on down into their stomachs. Just like that, down it goes. One more over here. Okay, same thing. Head back, down it goes. One last piece here. Wanna come out? Come on. Make your work for it. Big lazy alligator. Just toss it over here. You guys will notice we don't feed them all during the show. We only feed out like 12 pieces of food at every show we do. That's not a big deal. That's actually one of the advantages to being cold-blooded, is they have a real slow metabolism. It allows them to go long periods of time without eating, and it won't affect them like it would to you and I. So out here, we don't get too concerned if some of them haven't eaten all day or all week, and I'm even willing to bet some of these animals have probably gone all summer without eating. Okay? Now, like you said, not a big deal. The hungry ones are the ones that are approaching us for the food. The less hungry ones are the ones who just kind of hang out, kind of do their own thing. So like I said, I don't have to sit here and keep track of who fed from one show to the next. You guys want to hang tight here for a second? I've got one last thing here for you. I'm going to run back and rinse my hands off. And I've got about 2.5 to maybe 3.5-year-old alligator. His name is Fluffy. I'm going to tape his mouth shut, and I'll meet you guys up between the two fences. And if you want to stick around, you can come up. We'll let you pet him. You can find out what a real alligator feels like. or if you guys have any other questions, I'll try and answer them for you at that time as well. Otherwise, that pretty much wraps up the Alligator Show. I hope you guys enjoyed the programs.